We're going to talk about therapeutic humor, laughter with a purpose, mirth with a message, humor that heals, keynotes that enlighten, educate, and entertain, all from a speaker who is not only funny, but who is a neurohumorist, one who researches the neurobiology of humor and then translates these cutting-edge findings for the layperson, showing how they can harness, apply humor to heal and empower themselves. Audience loved Karyn Buxman's message of laughter and leadership. In 1 month, she spoke for the Million Dollar Round Table, the U.S. Air Force, the Mayo Clinic, Pfizer, and the Association for Peri-Operative Room Nurses. Karyn is the National Speakers Association Speaker Hall of Fame. She is proud recipient of the Lifetime Achievement Award from the Association for Applied and Therapeutic Humor. She serves on the advisory boards of the Invisible Disabilities Association and the American Happiness Association. She's the co-founder of World of Laughter Tour. That's why Karyn Buxman is the best person to teach your team how they can lead with laughter. And by the way, she's an author of numerous books and articles too. Aren't we surprised? What better expert on therapeutic humor and brain health? Karyn Buxman.
Thank you. Yes, thank you. Nicely done. Let's see, is it turned on? Now it is. Awesome, awesome. Speaker, author, neurohumorist. I know what you're thinking. Another neurohumorist. Lord. If I could show you how to build a healthier brain, and I could show you how to strengthen your relationships, and I could show you how to improve your business, to increase your sales, to make your leadership more significant, and to overall just be happier, would you be interested? Yes. Great. And if I could show you how to do that without breaking the bank, without breaking a sweat, without eating kale, and just having fun, would you be willing to make a commitment, to make one small change in your life every day over the next 30 days? Would you be willing to do that? Yeah. All right, then let's get started. Yes, I love, love, love talking about this topic. And let's see if we have, let's try next slide. I know, but it's not working. I knew that. Just recently, I was driving to an engagement, and my driver said, "Oh, I understand you're one of the speakers. What are you going to be speaking about?" And I said, "I'm going to be speaking about humor." And in all sincerity, he said, "Did you know humor is good for you?" Really? Why don't you? And he went on and on. He started telling me all about the wonderful kinds of things about humor. And I was thinking to myself, why is it that almost everybody in here in the world knows that humor is good for them? But so often we use it when it happens by chance, but we don't use it by choice. And the difference between those who get an occasional benefit and those who can do the things that I talked about, changing your brain, changing your business, changing your sales, changing your life, changing your relationships, changing your emotional well-being, the difference is that people who do it purposefully, intentionally, consistently, these are the people who can experience those benefits. There's lots of different ways we could address this. In the amount of time I have, Dr. Heidi Hanna and many of the other speakers could tell you, we really would love to be up here for about 6 hours because there still wouldn't be enough time to tell you all that we want to talk about. But I'm going to put this particular presentation in a framework that I think most of you would be able to relate to. Not too long ago, I was in Maine having my first lobster roll, and while I was seated waiting for them to bring my dish to me, I noticed this fishbowl up on the counter. And when I looked a little closer, I realized it was a blender with a fish in it, which is why it's called Mr. Chips. Now, to somebody who is a healthcare professional, we like body fluids, death, and dismemberment humor. So I thought this was really very funny. But the other thing that I thought about this in terms of most of us is, how many of you have ever felt like you're in that fishbowl just waiting for somebody to hit that button? Just waiting for somebody to hit that button. And when we are experiencing this, whether it's subtly or whether it's in our face, certain things are happening in our brains and in our bodies. And we've studied through psychoneuroimmunology, one of the terms that's been thrown around here earlier, and we know that stress affects every single body system in a negative way. If you have too much stress, distress, little is good. But stress in the brain, this is my lovely granddaughter, Ayla. Stress in the brain, the way that stress behaves is that first it stimulates our autonomic nervous system. And I'm not going to go into a lot of detail because I don't have a lot of time, but this, in addition, creates additional changes because the autonomic nervous system, which is from the adrenal glands, and it produces certain chemicals and hormones, but one of the things it produces is cortisol. And according to an article that was in Psychology Today, cortisol, public enemy number one. It is the underpinning of almost all of the negative diseases that we are here for today, inflammatory diseases, autoimmune diseases, diabetes, heart disease, Alzheimer's, all of these kinds of things are, the cortisol just fans the flames of making these worse. So the good news is that humor is the antithesis to almost every negative response that we experience in the brain. Our friend and colleague, Dr. Lee Burke, once said that if we could take what we know now about laughter and bottle it, it would require FDA approval. I get so excited, I just want to jump out of my skin because the research is growing and growing. We are pioneers in a field that is showing us the power of humor. How many of you in here know a person with diabetes or is a pre-diabetic? Right now in the US, 1 in 10, by 2050, proposed to be 1 in 3. How many of you know of someone who has heart disease of some kind? How many of you have ever experienced a short-term memory issue? How many of you in here have ever experienced a short-term memory issue? Just issue after issue after issue, we find that humor is power. Now, I want you to think back as a little exercise when the last time was that you had a really good laugh. And I'm seeing a few blank faces here. So we're going to do some research. This is a research-based symposium. And so what I'm going to ask you to do is take a giant leap of faith. And if you are physically able, on the count of three, I want you to face me and put the shape of a smile on your face. Then I will give you one last set of instructions. You may groan loudly, sit down, and we will discuss the findings of our research. If you're not able to stand, feel free to do this from a seated position. All right, on the count of three, 1, 2, 3, stand, and take a deep breath and let it out. And now put the shape of a smile on your face. For the purpose of our research, I need to see teeth. Don't care if they're yours. Just want to see a smile. And the last set of instructions is to turn and make eye contact with the victim who is standing close by. Now you can take a deep breath, sit down, and groan. I love doing this exercise for two reasons. One is if one of you just has to duck out before I'm done, and I hope that's not the case, but I wanted to make sure that every single person in here walks away with at least one skill. The next time you go back to your office tomorrow and you feel like if one more person puts one more thing on your desk and you have to just strangle them, I want you to face your doorway, entryway, or hallway and just do this. Because the next person that walks in and sees you looking like this is going to know now is not the time to bother you. The second reason is you are now healthier than you were when you started this presentation, from when you came in this morning. Different things happened in your body. You went from a fake smile to the majority of you went to an actual real smile. And for many of you who are the advanced group, you began to laugh. I didn't even ask you to smile, but you were laughing. Now, interestingly enough, with humor, there are components, different components in the brain. Humor is made up of a cognitive component in the prefrontal cortex. It's made up of an emotional component, which is mirth in the limbic system. And then there's the physiological component, laughter, which is actually starts in the base of the brain and then spreads all over your body. So your entire brain is engaged. Some of the research that has come out has been so exciting, and I just want to list a few. But for instance, some of the studies on persons with diabetes. Again, very, very difficult disease to manage for some people. And they did a study, and it's been replicated on several occasions, that persons with diabetes and pre-diabetics were asked to watch funny videos. They also had a control group of people who did not have diabetes or were not pre-diabetics. The findings were that the control group, it really didn't change anything in terms of blood glucose or other related issues of diabetes. But for those who were diabetics or pre-diabetics, there was a measurable, significantly, statistically significant decrease in their blood glucose and in their renin and angiotensin. These are hormones and proteins that will damage kidneys over a period of time. And so this is really, really very good news for persons with this disease. And even better, and to our surprise, we found out at the epigenetics level that we were seeing changes at the level of the DNA. If we're going to change the face of global health and we're looking at diabetes going to 1 in 3 people, we got to think outside of the box, people. What if we could implement something like this? Dr. Michael Miller, another friend and colleague from Baltimore, did studies on people with cardiovascular disease. And what he found was that people who purposefully and intentionally used humor had an increase in the elasticity of their endothelial lining of their blood vessels. For those of you who are not healthcare professionals, that means their blood vessels got stretchier and it lowered their blood pressure. Cortisol causes inflammation throughout our bodies, whether we notice it or not. Not necessarily painful, but in our blood vessels, when they become inflamed, what is our body's response? But to lay down plaque. By decreasing cortisol, which is one of the effects of humor and laughter, we can decrease that inflammation and we can decrease the need for the body to lay down plaque. But he thinks that this is a wonderful, wonderful future for people who are suffering or facing cardiovascular disease. In a study that's been done but not yet published but presented by another colleague of ours, they studied people who were over 50, but I'm going to generalize a little bit, But they found that when they intentionally and purposely watched humor, their short-term memory improved. And in another study, when they did brain imaging, and they did control groups, one group who just watched a lecture, another group who watched Saving Private Ryan, there's a relaxing movie for you, and then another group that got to self-select something funny to them, because what might be funny to me might not be funny to you, but they got to self-select humor. And here is one of the things that I think is the coolest thing I've heard all year. And that is that when they did brain imaging, they found that there was gamma waves across the entire brain. Gamma waves, like we see in people who practice intentional, purposeful meditation over years and years and years. We don't even know what to do with this information yet. But man, wouldn't it be cool if you could laugh and experience those gamma waves into better health like that we know to be true with meditation. Applied in therapeutic humor is very much where meditation was, I think, 20, 25 years ago when we talked about meditation and people rolled their eyes so hard you could hear their head ring and they were like, oh, but that's what the people in California do. that's those, you know, nuts and flakes and weird people. But what we're finding now is that this is so powerful and this is just the tip of the iceberg. I love this quote by Viktor Frankl. And if you have not yet read Man's Search for Meaning, it should be on your list of top 100 books to read in your life. But I think what he said here was one of the most powerful things I've ever heard. Between stimulus and response, there is a space. And in that space lies our freedom and our power to choose our response. And in our response lies our growth and our happiness. Stimulus, response. Stimulus, response. Stimulus, response. Stimulus, response. In that space. So often we think, well, I don't have a choice. Somebody cut me off, and of course I'm just going to go bam on the horn because that's how I'm wired. But there's a space, and you have a choice. And I'm not saying that humor is the only thing that you should put in that space. But now, once you leave this room today, you will know too much that you can no longer just say, I'm at the mercy of other people. I'm at the mercy of my circumstances because you have a choice. And one of those choices between stimulus and response is humor. Powerful stuff. Hebb's Law. Yeah, we've talked about this already. Neurons that fire together, wire together. So often our brains, we've already been wired to have that negative response. The anxiety goes up. The fear goes up. The muscles get tight. And we have this exhibited throughout our bodies, all sorts of bad things going on chemically, emotionally, socially, psychologically. But we can rewire our brains if we're intentional and use humor, not by chance, but by choice. Now, a lot of people go, but you don't understand. There's nothing funny happening in my life. There's nothing funny happening where I work. There's no humor around. And let me tell you this, if this is your belief, then this is your truth. If you believe there's no humor in your life, you're gonna be right. But if you believe, well, maybe I'm missing something, you'll be right. Five strategies. I'm gonna give you five strategies. Now, pick one. I don't expect you to do all of these because you would not be able to do them consistently. But I'm going to give you five strategies, and I want you to think, because you guys told me earlier, if I could show you how to make these changes, that you would be willing to make one small change consistently. So let's start with manipulating your mindset. How can you reframe your pain? Sometimes it's just by posing a question to yourself or a statement. I loved it when a social worker told me his way of reframing things was to ask himself, Has this changed the Earth's rotation? If it hadn't, he felt it would be safe to let it go. Sometimes it's to catastrophize. Have you ever heard that word? Make it worse and worse and worse until it's so absurd that you can look at the original premise and go, okay, not that bad, not that bad. Asking yourself, how could this be worse? And then ask it again mirthfully, and again, and again, and again. To listen for different things that people say, listen for different things that you will hear. If you raise your awareness, you will hear things that other people are missing. Once when I was working here in Colorado, there was a person there who represented the Colorado, actually it was Denver's, Visitors and Convention Center. And they said there was somebody who wanted to come visit Denver, but before they came to Colorado, they wanted to know, what time of year do your deer turn into elk? You don't have to make this stuff up. So often when I share things, people go, is that true? Heidi, Hannah, and others can tell you, I never have to make up stuff because this kind of stuff just happens, but I'm listening for it. You never have to be funny. Sometimes people go, but I'm not a funny person. I'm not a funny person. If you can make someone else laugh, awesome. That is a skill. And I could teach every single one of you how to be funny, but it might not serve you. I know a lot of people who are funny who have no sense of humor. I know a lot of people who are funny, who are very depressed, and or like Robin Williams, dead. I don't care if you're funny. I want you to see funny. An exercise that I teach a lot of my audiences is yellow car. It was an exercise that I learned from this wonderfully hysterical podcast. If you ever have the opportunity to listen to the BBC radio show, it's called Cabin Pressure, starring Benedict Cumberbatch, be still my heart. And one of the people on there said, let's play yellow car. Well, how do you play? Well, every time we're in a car together and we see a yellow car, the person that sees it shouts, yellow car. Well, how do you keep score? Well, you don't keep score. Well, how do you win? Well, you don't win. Well, how is the game over? The game's never over. You're always playing yellow car. And so I thought, well, I'm going to teach this, and we were going to videotape this for an exercise that I did. And we started driving around, and my husband was videotaping me, and we drove around, and it's like, oh, no yellow cars. And the next day we went out, well, there's one parked. Well, there's another one parked. And, you know, and after a while, the next day it was like, well, there's one. And then a couple days later, well, there's a couple. And by the end of the week, it was like, oh, look, San Diego is getting more yellow cars. By the end of the month, I wanted to claw my eyes out. I cannot stop seeing yellow cars because I rewired my brain. Neurons that fire together, wire together. I just had someone from a presentation that I did in Austin 2 days ago. She texted me and she said, I can't stop seeing yellow cars. But once you raise your awareness, you will see things like this. Pull? Are you kidding me? No, there's no handles. You can't do that. This was in a restaurant the other day that I attended in San Diego. This is a garage with a sense of humor. It's just a few blocks from where I live. The top of it said, knock, knock. And I was like, what's that? But then the garage door lifted and underneath it said, who's there? I was like, woo! Notice, this is a drug-free workspace. I don't think so. I love this. I am Republican, Democrat, having a glass of wine. Number two, manipulate your environment. What can you do to increase the likelihood? Surround yourself with things that will increase. On my smartphone, I have podcasts, I have videos, I have funny pictures, I have memes, I have things TiVo'd at home, I have things that I can go to, I have books, anything that I can do to surround myself so that I can purposely 20 minutes every single day get some kind of humor, whether I'm on a plane, on a stage, or wherever I may be. So increase the likelihood in your environment. Find an accountability partner. Find someone that you can share with. I'm fortunate enough to have an accountability partner with a wonderful sense of humor. Dr. Hannah and I were putting on a 24-hour longest day seminar for people who were caregivers of Alzheimer's. I didn't realize that the screen capture caught me in the background doing a chokehold to something she was saying. However, here's the thing. We have a commitment, and every single day we send each other humor. And what I found was not only the gift for me when I send her something, when I'm not feeling in a great mood, looking for humor to send to her changes my mindset. And when I send it to her, it makes me feel good. Two dopamine hits. And now I have a larger repertoire of material to send to somebody else. Three dopamine hits. So find an accountability partner. Four, schedule humor breaks. Schedule humor breaks. I make sure that every single day I do this, and now with smartphones, it's even easier. I'm pretty sure you can do this if you don't have an iPhone, but for those of you that have iPhones, you can schedule in your alarms, and I think the rest of you can figure this out. For instance, in my alarm, I can pick a time, and then where it says label, instead of just saying alarm, I write, schedule a humor break, and that goes off. So my day looks something like this. I have all sorts of alarms to just give me mental cues to lift my mood. But if you look at 8:30 in the morning on this particular day, it's practice a humor strategy. So I don't miss a day. So schedule a break. Five, become a student of humor. There are so many resources out there, and on the webpage that I have created just for you, we have additional resources. It's karynbuxman.com/IDA. So if you go to that, lots of resources. Number one that we love is the Association for Applied and Therapeutic Humor. They have a 3-year immersion program. Beyond Funny is another program that Heidi and I created. It's a nonprofit, but lots and lots of resources for you out there. What strategies will work for you? I want you to think about one. What is one that you can pick to do consistently? My friend and colleague Mark LeBlanc says, consistency trumps commitment every time. So I want you to either tweet or text or email me or your accountability partner. What's one commitment you're willing to make every day over the next 30 days? If you tweet it, put in 30-day humor, hashtag brain ideas, and we'll follow and support one another. Humor is power. I know with every single fiber of my being, it can change our brains. It can change our lives. It can change our world. How many of you are familiar with the movie Spider-Man? There's a scene where Peter Parker, aka Spider-Man, his uncle's talking to him, and he says, "With great power comes great responsibility," right? So I ask you to join me in my mission to improve world health, global business, world peace through laughter, and heal the humor impaired. Thank you.